Looking at a science paper online, you might think it's legit, but it could be coming from a predatory journal. Journals that pump out junk science. Now, Jeffrey Beall is a retired academic librarian who was one of the first to draw attention to this whole predatory journal phenomenon. Great to have you, Jeffrey.
Thank you.
Jeffrey, I understand you noticed a major problem with predatory journals almost 20 years ago. What did you decide to do about it, you know, in your own capacity?
Well, I decided to track them, and I created and published a list of predatory publishers and standalone predatory journals.
And when you were looking at that list, like, how would people make the list?
I established a set of criteria for judging the journals and publishers, and I just based the list on those that met the criteria.
And I feel like, you know, putting out a list like that would help a lot of people. You know, what happened in the aftermath of putting that out there?
It did help a lot of people, but it also made a lot of people angry, especially the publishers, because it reduced their income because it made people want to avoid submitting manuscripts to their journals.
And so what was the repercussions on you?
A lot of people just became very angry with me. There were lawsuit threats. Authors who used the journals for easy places to publish also became very angry with me. And I received a lot of pressure from my university as well.
Wow. And this is known, you know, as Beall's List. People, if they're, you know, Googling about predatory journals, you will see this list or people talking about it when they talk about this subject. So, Jeffrey, you know, you talked about the threats and the pressure. What does that reveal about the influence and the power that these predatory publishers have?
Well, I think a lot of it relates to money and income. The publishing model that they use is called Gold Open Access. And in that model, the authors have to pay a fee to the publishers when their work is accepted for publication. So they make a lot of money. So anybody who tries to draw authors away from submitting manuscripts to them is targeted by them because it directly impacts their income.
So it's a big money-making business. And when people mess with that, they're not happy.
Exactly.
Yeah. Hmm. You talk about that pressure. I mean, that must have taken a personal toll on you.
It was tough. I managed to last for 5 years. I published the list from 2012 to early 2017.
Okay. So it was there for a few years, and now technically it's not supposed to be there, but people still need help in this domain. You know, Jeffrey, when you look at the problem, you know, what is your biggest concern at this point?
Well, like the woman said in the clip just a minute ago, the biggest concern is the threat to science. The predatory publishers will publish articles that have not been properly vetted through the peer review process, and those are published and made open access for anybody to read, and they pollute science.
And what does that pollution of science do, you know, in the real world? Like when you look at what's happening in the world, do you see things as a librarian and think, oh my goodness, that is scary?
It's scary because, especially with medical research, because doctors may apply what they read in articles in a clinical setting.
Like people going to their doctors might get wrong information?
Exactly, or wrong treatment.
What is the worst case scenario in your mind if this continues to get out of control?
Well, science is continuing to be polluted. Also, some researchers use the easy publishing that the predatory publishers offer because they don't do a proper peer review. So they can publish a lot of articles really quickly without really doing enough research, just drop articles and submit them and pay and get them accepted. And then they can improve their annual evaluations at the university. They can get tenure gratuitously. They can also, some people get PhD students who publish a lot in predatory journals can get jobs with a very impressive vita when they really didn't do sufficient work to earn a long list of publications.
Wow. So they could just rise up the food chain without the qualifications, without the science behind them, and then we are impacted by that research.
Precisely.
When you look at the growth of the predatory journals and you look at people trying to stop it, Jeffrey, do you think we can do anything to stop it at this point?
there's really no way to stop them. They're not doing anything illegal. They're publishers and they have freedom of the press. In most cases, they're not doing anything illegal. So that's why I used the list approach, was to try and just get information out there so people could avoid them.
Yeah, just like a warning sign almost.
Exactly.
I know your list is now down because of all the pressure. Technically, it still lives in different places online, not that you have put it out there. But your work carries on in other people that are trying to curb the problem. We were talking with an organization called Think, Check, Submit, which is trying to do their best and their part to stop some of these predatory journals. And we had Lorena Stell with us, and let's take a listen to her clip.
There are two checklists available for researchers, one for journals and one for books and publishers. And those checklists are really there to help researchers decide if the publisher or the journal is trustworthy. The checklists remind the researchers that more and more journals, more and more publishers are appearing every week, and then guides them through a series of questions which will help them evaluate if that journal or that publisher is to be trusted.
So Jeffrey, that's one effort being put forward by a small organization. Do you think that's enough when we look at the landscape of what we're dealing with?
It's a good start. I think it should be called Think, Check, Don't Submit, because in most cases, when you deal with predatory publishers, you want to avoid them as much as possible. The advantage of my list was that the work was already done for you, and you could save a lot of time by just looking at the list to see if a prospective journal was on it, and then if it is, avoid it completely.
You know, with open access now, so many people are doing their own research. They're trying to read studies for themselves. Do you have any tips for them when they're looking at these journals in terms of how to evaluate, you know, if the study is a good one or a bad one?
I would say determine which are the top journals in a given field. Find out where the top scientists are publishing from your local university. And stick with those journals. Be very careful, because predatory journals often use titles that are very close to established and respected journals. So it can be a very tricky minefield that you're walking through. So just the best thing is to look for the journals where the top researchers are publishing.
Okay, so stick to the big dogs for now, and do your research, right? Do your homework, which it all comes back to when we're talking about science.
Absolutely, exactly.
Jeffrey, so great to have you on the program. I'm so encouraged that, you know, you tried to fight this thing. And even though, you know, the list is officially pulled down, like, people still talk about, they know that you tried, and this conversation continues. So thank you for being on the program.
Thanks for having me.